Okay, today I'm gonna be continuing my drawing series about the seven dead sinners, which I'm making for my undead compendium for tabletop RPGs. Seven dead sinners. And today we're going to be drawing. We're gonna start with Sloth. So, Sloth. I think Sloth. I think Snorlax. But he's kind of a gluttony thing too, so I don't know how far we want to go up down the Snorlax train here. But I'm just going to start with a head down here. I kind of confine myself to this size if I start here. I think I'm good with that. Have this come in and then the neck here. That's kind of what a skull would be shaped like. We're gonna put hair and stuff on this one. This is a little bit hard. Not used to drawing heads at this angle. I'm guessing Sloth includes like messy hair even, right? Probably. Pretty all-inclusive on the Sloth train here. He can have eyebrows though. Yep. Messy hair. And then I'm thinking, you know, he doesn't even have the wherewithal to get his arms up on his chest. He's just got an arm flopping out this way. It's hard. I usually draw more muscular characters, and it's hard not to continue that with these undead. But since we're going directly for Sloth, right, you gotta be pretty dedicated to get muscular, so we're gonna have a flabby arm here. And just kinda rolls. Another arm sticking out this way, and maybe a little bit more of a belly here. Sloth, we gotta get everything we can out of Sloth here, right? So, what am I thinking? I'm thinking, like, Sloth is also not bathing. Yeah, probably. So we're just gonna have, in addition to the gloppiness of this creature, like just a pool of ick around this guy. I don't know. I'm not, just not happy with the head shape there. Kind of turned outward, I guess. Like a toe there. copy. And then we're gonna have other knee. Sorry, I'm stalling on the elbow here because I don't know which way I want the elbow to be turning. If I'm sprawled out on the ground, do I have my elbow turned up toward my head? Oh, probably not, right? So, bicep is turned this way. There we got. Okay. The thumb's gonna be up toward the head. Alright, looks like I ran out of space on my phone while I was finishing the pencil on the sloth drawing, but we're back for inking. We cleared up plenty of space, and we're gonna start by inking the things that are out in front here, right? So we got this cloud of stench coming off of his armpit here. Now, when we go to color this, we're actually going to have the line behind it exist, but we're going to put the color in here in front of the line to make it somewhat opaque, right, when we get to the coloring part. So it's not terribly important that we do these first, but we might as well. The important part here is to get just solid lines that Photoshop or GIMP will be able to pull out for us to use when we're doing our color on it. We make it as easy as possible for us to get the result that we're looking for. All right. Well, I just put an extra one right over the top of that fly. So we're gonna have to put that fly somewhere else. And then I guess I'm just going to start down here at the toes. Nice pudgy toes. Should have started with the top toe because it's over the top of these other ones. It'll be alright though. Come up to the calf here. I guess that's the shin. Turn toward us. Get this knee. There should probably be some like slop over the knee here. I don't know. He's dead and decaying, so he doesn't have to look entirely humanoid, right? He can have fat in weird places. We just want the rolls to be as complete as possible. It's gonna come right through that stench cloud. Definitely want the belly button. We could fill it in now, or we can fill it on the computer, maybe have a little more depth to it. I think I'll fill it in now. We'll put a little fly on him. Part of what I'm trying to get across in this series is you might see something like the Drawfee channel, right, or other artists doing like live drawings, like some webcomic people do live drawings, and they're using a Cintiq drawing pad, and they got all these cool skills. And the point I want to get across is you don't need the drawing pad or the training to do something halfway decent, right? And those people are amazing, right? But this, you don't need that stuff to get something okay put together, right? Obviously, I would love to have a Cintiq and do this stuff, but it's just a hobby. And it's just not worth it to me to buy one for my hobby. And so I jumped right in and discovered that this worked just fine for my needs, and it might work for your needs as well. And that's the purpose of this series, is to show that you don't need the fancy stuff to go ahead and get started. Because I would say, if you can't do it on pen and paper with a little extra time, then the drawing pad's actually not going to help you much, right? It'll help you with maybe get it done quicker, because you can go back and erase things and stuff, and you don't have to go over it twice like I'm doing the pencil, and then I'm going to go back through, and you can edit after coloring, which is a pretty good advantage, right? So it could help with your quality a little bit, and it certainly helps with the amount of time that it takes. But I would say, before you make that investment, if you're just an amateur doing this, like me, just try it with pen on paper. And if you can stand to do it with pen on paper and it's working okay, then I'm sure that you'd be willing to put the time in and do some really good stuff on the Cintiq. But if you just don't find this very interesting to do on pen and paper, it's probably not worth the investment to get the Cintiq. I can't imagine that it's that much different. But maybe it is. Maybe it's a lot easier. Maybe it's a lot better. But my take is, it's a tool, and if you're not getting the job done with mediocre tools, really good tools aren't gonna make you any more likely to go get the job done. If you don't care enough to try it with what you have, then I don't think that it's gonna matter when you get the better stuff. So what I might do is even set a goal for some drawings that you'd like to do and get them done with just the pen and the paper. And then if you hit that goal, then you've earned yourself that Cintiq, right? You've proven that you're going to use it. And you've put in the effort, and you're going to appreciate it when you have it. That's my take on the getting high-tech stuff for your hobbies question. So, is that enough flies flying around him? I think so. I think that looks pretty good. So with that, we're going to move on to the next one. All right, so with Sloth all inked in and the pencil erased and scanned into the computer, we are ready to start making it a color picture. So we're gonna turn the contrast way up. Brightness doesn't matter. Contrast way up, make the lines really solid. We're gonna say okay to that. And that gets rid of a lot of the smudging that used to be here. And then we're getting, let's just undo to show how it got rid of the smudging. Boop. You see all the smudging there and how loose this all was? And then when we up the contrast, all those smudges are gone. It's nice and clean. We're going to do a select by color and select the white. Invert to the not white.
Because some of that not white includes weird colors in here from the way the contrast algorithm works, at least in GIMP. We're just gonna go over all that with a nice big black brush. May have gone too big. It's lagging. Oh dear. My computer may crash as a result of coloring that all black. That's pretty disappointing, GIMP. Give it a minute. Cut all this out. It's taking too long. Taking too long. Taking too long. I've never had this happen before. There you go. Looks like we are covered. So take that size down significantly. And now the computer can do it fine. I think we got everything. We'll do one more pass to make sure. Alright, next thing, we're gonna switch back to the white and delete the white. We can't delete the white. So we're gonna select all. Copy, paste, new layer, delete the old layer, and on this layer, we can erase all the white. And just like that, we got no white on this layer. We're going to duplicate the layer, so we're going to have an ink layer. And a color layer. Now this guy's going to get a little complicated because we want him to do some transparent layers on it. And I honestly don't remember how I've done that in the past, so we'll tackle that when we get to it. This guy's sloth, we've been doing... We've had various skin tones, really. We're going to go for something a little more greenish on this guy. And his hair is not going to be the green color. That's pretty inconvenient that I did that. But in here, we're going to do it green, since those are the parts we're going to try to make transparent. And that looks like everything. I don't know what to do about that. I guess we'll just make it green too. Make life easier for us. The space behind them, so we'll leave it. Alright. Now we need to do something. Thinking we want a layer like this, and we want to drop its opacity down to like 50%, and then we want to do these tendrils of icky, smelly stuff. Just do them whatever color we want to not have the line. this is to get the transparency colors. I need to remove these lines because they're not on the transparency layer. I wish I could remember how I did it for my crab. It's probably something like this. Looks like that takes care of it. Paint bucket back. We're gonna bucket in these bloop, 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 bloop. So you can see now that that is clearly passing in front of these lines here. We can play with the color, make it a little thicker. As we please. So that looks pretty good to me for now. Now we need like a toenail color. Looks pretty good to me. Just plop it in here. Oh, we are still on the stench layer. I'm gonna go back to the main layer. Color in each of these toenails, this green. Palm lines. I kind of wish he had palm lines. And I kind of want to fill that in. Now we need a color for the ick that he's lying in. I don't know. We just want kind of a diarrhea-y color, right? That'll work. Doesn't have a lot of pleasant colors on him, does he? And make his hair though like a darkish brown. So let's darken it up a little more. A little more down here. Yeah. So this is gonna get a little interesting since we need to separate it out. So I'm going to go with a single pixel draw here. I'm going to select just this so I don't screw anything up. And come down in here. And those are flies. They don't look like flies when you get this close. I'm just going to finish up these borders here that I didn't do in pen. I think it'll look okay to have them. Not have a pen border. You might want to come in with like a spray paint version and soften them up later. But for now, that looks pretty good. That's right, we can't paint there because we don't have a select them. Alright, so there's some hair on this guy. And the last thing he's got left is his eye. And all we should do that little dot. And so for the eye, been doing kind of glossy eyes, right? So here, well, I think that's kind of the gray that I've been using. It's not. Really light gray for the eye. Could go white, I guess. I like it a little bit gray. Down to a single pixel, which I thought we were in single pixel. So we're going to do a darker gray. That's too dark. Well, first let's do like a light blue for his eye color. Just a little gray, so let's do, yeah. Well, that's good. I think we'll leave it at that. So we're gonna go to a decent round size dabbler. Select by color on the white. Just plop an iris on here. Yeah. Now we're gonna select by color on the irises and do some darker gray pupils with like maybe that gray, no, a little darker than that. A little bit more. So go back to our pen and go a little smaller, just a little roundish. Too big. My pupil is too big. That's a good creepy eye for him, staring off into space. And that is it for color in this guy. So the next step is to do some shadows on him. So the shadows are going to be on a new layer, and they're going to be behind the foreground but in front of the color layer. I don't know what we're going to do about this ink layer now, that in fact we're going to move the foreground layer in front of it so that we can use it like this. Yeah, so shadow layer. So this one we're gonna be doing just black and pretty much just the spray bottle at a hardness that is not one. And I'm gonna start by doing his, well, so you're gonna select the colors on the color layer and then come back to the shadow layer. So we're gonna do the shadow on his entire body. Daunting as that is, and we're going to want something significantly bigger for these big fat legs. Most of his arms are upward, but we can come through and do like a little bit on both sides. I guess what we want to do is stick with a big one and then just keep our distance. There. We're going to come down this side as well. Chaser back out with hardness on. Stuff that came through onto the sunny side of him. Yeah. I'll get the spray can with the lower hardness out again and come up in here and do a little bit on this arm. Again, clean the face up. Not doing the face yet. Oops, I cleaned the neck up there. I didn't mean to. Maybe I'm gonna have to shrink my eraser so I don't get the neck. Looks like I can get it. Now we're gonna wanna go do the spray bottle at a smaller size. We've done everything that is facing the ground, but we want to get all the folds and things like that. So like this will do. Okay, what just happened? Screwed up my tool. Oh my goodness. I want my toolbox. I want to be able to resize my pens. Oh, here we go. Good. I just switched tools. Good, good, good. Thanks. I think we need a softer brush for this. So I'm gonna try it. Just having trouble falling that way. Here we go. Focus. Gonna come and follow each of these folds. I committed to doing it on the left side, the footward side. What do you call that? Like pectoral would be front and dorsal would be back. What is top to bottom though? Is it fore and aft? Is it? Not up and down. I don't know. I'm not a doctor. I do not know what you would call it. Anterior, posterior. Nope, not coming to me. Theme from Sid the Science Kid stuck in my head. Kid's been watching that lately. It's not terrible. It's a little fun how the kids move exactly like kids in the show. You'll see much of that. Duration quality is really high on it. So, I'm gonna go with a little more on this belly. And we should be able to see it. I think we can. I think we can see it behind the should definitely get some shade on the downward side of them. Oh, come on. Computer's lagging just a bit. Didn't screw anything up yet, though. Do something about these, but I don't know what. I guess they're fine. I think I wanna. Damn. Alright, you're gonna have to do it the hard way. So we're gonna go big. Get the forearm here. For shade on this guy, probably want to do a little more carefully around the mouth and stuff. Oh, we haven't done the hair yet either. Should do the hair. Just a little bit in here. Kind of on the bridge of the nose here. A little over on the far side of the face. And then we're going to want to select the hair. Actually, I want to make sure. We'll catch it later. So, shade on the hair. I don't think it's going to come through very much because the hair is so dark. But we're going to come through here and just. It's coming through okay. Just get the undersides. I think we're going to come, since his hair is greasy and stuff, and put kind of highlights in it later too. I want dark to capture the greasiness, but it didn't quite do it, so we're gonna have to come through and make the hair a little more interesting, I think. Out of the way, please. Shadows. Take it back. We need a little bit around the eyes. Very small. The black should protect the other colors, so this should be just fine like this. Cool. And that should be it for shade. So I'm going to select the transparency layer and come back to the shadow layer, and on the shadow layer I'm going to erase anything that accidentally got on the transparency layer because it shouldn't have. guess what we missed on shadows. We didn't do the puddle. Oh my goodness, computer. I restarted you and shut down all the other programs that were running so that you wouldn't do this. But yeah, we want to come back in and just do a real heavy shadow on the puddle underneath him, right? So we're going to select the puddle color and just come along underneath him. Oh, we got to be on top of him. Alright, so let's get a bigger brush. I want this to be pretty deep. Good. So, next thing would be to do the highlight layer. There's not much to highlight since he's all skin and skin's not super reflective, but we can do a highlight layer. So, I'm gonna make the brush a little less opaque. I'm gonna pick a yellowish white color. And I'm going to select his skin here. Okay, yeah, obviously that failed. Select his skin here, come back to the highlight layer, and just whoop. Did that do anything at all? His skin's so green that the yellow highlight isn't coming out at all. A little bit. Especially when it was on top of the shadow. It made the shadow basically go away. So we don't want to be that large. We can put a little highlight on him. Make it clear where the raised edges are. Nose here, on the forehead, a little there, a little on the front of the ear, I guess a little along the top middle of the arm. Yuck, that did not work well at all. Let's drop the hardness and see if, maybe if we go really big and really drop the opacity, we can get something soft. Non-existent, maybe. Okay, yeah, I think that's right. So let's just come down the middle here. I'm gonna go back and do shading on the fingers. I missed those. Shrink it back again and go to the old hardness and opacity and come along the legs here. Too big. That's better. The highlights barely show up, but they can make it look a little more three-dimensional on a subconscious level. And since it's subconscious, we can be kind of sloppy with it. It's okay. So I think that's good. Select a different color. shadows for the puddle in the puddle. Oh well, not going back at this point. Put some shine around the edge of the puddle. Okay. Putting shine in the eye, but I want to try putting some shine on the hair, which is apparently the same color as that now. And we're going to come back to the highlight layer and put some shine on the hair again with a very small brush and a very low hardness and a very low opacity. It looks okay. And we could call it there. That could be it. Considering trying to texture the hair a little bit. Let's give it a whirl. New layer. I just want to take like the same brown that we had and then make it a little bit lighter brown. And I don't know, just kinda to put some highlights in below the shadow layer. I just remembered I want shadows on the fingers. Select this color, shadow layer, black, airbrush, raise the opacity. Just come right between the fingers there. Not super fond of these fingers. I guess I got lazy during the pen. That helps them a little bit though. And there we have it. All colored and ready to be put in a document.